In our previous video, we covered the basics of CSS grid layouts and created a full-height page with an expandable sidebar. In this video, we will explore more complex scenarios by building a fully responsive dashboard layout that showcases advanced grid placement techniques and demonstrates how to design adaptable grid structures. Before we begin, make sure to hit the subscribe button and ring the notification bell to stay updated on upcoming tutorials. You're watching Optimistic Web, where we explore the world of CSS and front-end development, one step at a time. We are using the same HTML from our previous video with an addition of multiple cards inside the main element. Each card shares a common CSS class along with its own subset to apply specific positioning. It's a straightforward example using regular HTML elements. Moving on to the CSS, in the last video, we applied a grid layout to the body tag and explored how grid template columns, grid template rows, and grid template areas can be used to create a responsive, full-height page layout. Let's start working on today's project. First of all, we will convert the main element into a grid container. It will maintain its default structure of single column with a gap of 1 rem between grid items. The media query will check for the viewport width, and if it is 768 pixels or more, the grid setup will switch to 4 columns, with each column taking up an equal amount of space. Now let's add some default styles for the card element to enhance the appearance. Since we don't have any content inside the cards, we can apply a minimum height to give them some size. In a real-world scenario, the cards would contain relevant content and adjust their size naturally. Then we will use the card-specific CSS class to apply the necessary styles following the design we are working on. Like in this example, we are adding a gradient background to the first card. And this is what we will see on small screen devices, a single column layout containing different cards to display relevant content. Now let's figure out the structure for medium-sized screens. In the previous video, we used the grid area CSS property to assign unique names to different HTML elements, like we used header, sidebar, main, and footer. We then positioned them in their designated spots using the grid template areas property. Besides using named areas, there are other ways to position items in a CSS grid layout. For instance, we can specify the starting and ending positions for a grid item. Before we move further, let's use the developer tools to inspect the layout and better understand a few more aspects of the CSS grid. A grid is made up of intersecting horizontal and vertical lines, which define the columns and rows. Each column and row is separated by a grid line. The horizontal lines are called row grid lines, while the vertical ones are called column grid lines. These grid lines are automatically assigned a number. For example, in this case, the row grid lines are labeled 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, and the column grid lines follow the same numbering pattern. These numbers can also be negative, starting from the last row and last column grid lines. We can use these line numbers to place a grid item precisely within the layout. In this example, the grid row start and grid row end properties are used to tell the browser that the first card should start at the first row grid line and end at the second row grid line. Similarly, we specify the column grid lines for the starting and ending positions. With this simple change, the first card now spans across the entire row. In simple words, we're instructing the browser that the first card should begin at the first row grid line and end at the second row grid line. On the block axis, it starts at the first column grid line and ends at the fifth column grid line. We can simplify this by using shorthand properties to combine the starting and ending positions. For example, the grid row and grid column properties allow us to specify the starting and ending line numbers, separated by a forward slash in a single rule. As we have seen, these line numbers can also be negative, so we can replace the ending column line number with -1. This can be further simplified using the grid area shorthand property. In this case, the first value is assigned to grid row start, the second value is for grid column start, the third is for grid row end, and the fourth one goes to grid column end. We can also use the span keyword to specify that the card should span 1 row and 4 columns. Since it's only taking up a single row, which is the default behavior, we can skip specifying the row and simply use the grid column property with the value of span 4. And then the remaining cards can span across two columns each, creating a clean two-column layout. Now let's adjust the layout for large screen devices. First, we reset the second and third cards to their default setup. Then cards 4 and 5 will move to their custom locations. Card 4 will start at the third row grid line and first column grid line, and ending at the fourth row grid line and second column grid line. And then cards 6 and 7 will span across two rows while maintaining a single column structure. Finally, the last four cards will follow the default configuration and keep four columns in a row. This is how we can use CSS Grid to create complex layouts and precisely arrange grid items in their designated cells. It offers a more intuitive and efficient way to design complex web pages compared to traditional methods like floats or inline block elements. CSS Grid is inherently responsive, making it ideal for creating layouts that adapt to various screen sizes and devices. Additionally, the use of media queries to adjust the grid layout and item placements based on the viewport size ensures that the website looks great everywhere. If you found this tutorial helpful, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe for more. Feel free to leave your questions or comments below. Thanks for watching, and see you in the next one.